For people experiencing homelessness, getting access to health care is extremely difficult but critical. Life on the streets is obviously dangerous, but also has ravaging effects on health. And for many years, those on the streets were largely disconnected from the medical community. That's one reason why a local doctor decided to devote his life's work to tending patients on the streets and connecting them to health care. He took his practice on the road literally for nearly 40 years. Since 1985, Dr. Jim O'Connell has been working on the streets of Boston out of a medically equipped van to bring medicine, blankets, and comfort to the homeless community. He also convinced many of those patients to come into his clinic. And what began with a small team of eight evolved into Boston Healthcare for the Homeless, with a team of more than 600, taking care of nearly 10,000 adults and children every year. His story is the focus of a new book, Rough Sleepers, by Pulitzer Prize-winning author Tracy Kidder, who followed Dr. Jim, as he's affectionately known among his patients, for 5 years. Dr. Jim, the founding president of Boston Healthcare for the Homeless, joins me now. Thank you very much. It's really an honor to have you here. I want to start out, some people are very familiar with your story, some people are not. In terms of how you got to what you're doing, you studied philosophy for many years. You thought about becoming a lawyer. And then you went to Harvard Medical School. You were headed to a fellowship in oncology at Sloan Kettering. But then you were offered this chance to work with homeless, bringing medical help to them on the streets. Can you describe that crossroads, help people understand, and what made you make the choice that you did?
Sure. I wish it had been offered, but I think it was more or less I was conscripted by my chief of medicine, a mentor of mine named Dr. John Potts, and Dr. Tom Durant, who is one of the real interesting community persons at Mass General Hospital. And they were working with Mayor Flynn to try to get a grant from the Robert Wood Johnson Foundation to take care of homeless people. And it turns out, to make a very long story short, the homeless folks who were involved in this wanted a full-time doctor and they couldn't find one. So I got called in. And as I've told people many times, when you get called into your chief of medicine's office, the questions are largely rhetorical. So I'm an accidental tourist in this. I thought I was doing this for 1 year and then I would get on with the rest of my life. So I wish I could say it was a life devotion initially, but it was not. It was an accident.
So early on in the book, Tracy Kidder writes, the work was appalling, overwhelming, and fascinating. Can you explain that?
Sure. I left Mass General, you know, where I had trained, and my last job was to be the senior resident in charge of the intensive care unit. And I remember going six blocks down the street to Pine Street Inn as my next duty and thinking, how tough can a shelter clinic be? And I walked in and saw a whole new world. I knew nothing about the remarkable work that Pine Street was doing, as was Long Island Shelter at the time. And there was a nurse's clinic there that had been functioning very independently without doctors for many years. But when I got into the lobby, it was, you know, 600 or 700 people in the lobby, the two lobbies. It was chaos. And I realized all of a sudden that I was out of control. In the ICU, I had lots of control. But there were all these illnesses I hadn't seen except often in textbooks. We were just beginning to cope with the AIDS epidemic in the homeless community. And there was an ongoing outbreak of multi-drug tuberculosis. So from the first night I got there, we were overwhelmed. And I was struck by how, you know, how one, busy and overwhelming it was, but two, how fascinating all the problems were, because we didn't have any of the tools to, we knew what to prescribe, but we didn't have any idea how to make those treatment plans work.
And I won't give anything away, but you referenced the nurses who were basically running this clinic. You had your own indoctrination by those nurses, which is fascinating and people should really read in the book. You also pioneered this outreach van. I believe that was really your push which created this, which now, does it still go out nightly?
It does. And what happened was during the first year, our program, our Boston Healthcare for the Homeless program's goal was to get our doctors and nurses out to wherever homeless people were, out in the shelters, soup kitchens, and we stayed close to both Mass General and Boston City Hospital, which is now Boston Medical Center. And we learned during that first year that the people that were dying turned out to be people who were not coming into these clinics that we thought were doing a marvelous job of getting to people. And so with a lot of help from the state and with the Pine Street Inn folks, especially Barbara McGinnis, who was the nurse that basically beat me up and told me what to do, and became my dear friend. But the thought was we needed to get out to the streets at nighttime. There's only a small number of what we call rough sleepers who are out in Boston. Most people will come into the shelters. But this group is, you know, numbers in the hundreds, not in the thousands. And they suffer from a huge burden of co-occurring medical and psychiatric and substance use disorders. And to get to them, we really had to go out at nighttime. So the state, the Department of Public Health of Massachusetts, gave money to Pine Street Inn to start this van. And really quickly, I wanted it to be a medical van because I said, this is our opportunity. But the homeless people, and we've always had homeless people. We've had a group of homeless people who are on our board of directors to this day. And they pretty much would tell us what was allowed and what wasn't. And they didn't want a medical van. What they wanted was a van to come out every night, 9 o'clock at night till 5 in the morning. It's run by Pine Street. They'd bring soup and sandwiches and blankets. So I got to go along in the van for a couple nights a week and, you know, serve sandwiches, soup and all that. But then let people know, by the way, if you need anything, I'm a doctor. And it turns out to be their idea, but it was a brilliant way to sort of break the ice and get to know people on the streets, most of whom were pretty crusty and scarred by not good encounters with the system. So it was the best thing that ever happened to me. And I still think of that as my sort of spiritual home in all this.
Are you still going out in the van?
I do. I go out in the van. I've had to, you know, since COVID, I've only been going out one night a week. So I kind of miss going out. But yes, no, I'll be out tomorrow night. I'll be out.
So there are many other things you sort of pioneered along the way, computerized records of the homeless, their medical records, respite for the homeless, those who were not sick enough perhaps to stay in a hospital, but needed a place so that they wouldn't have to recover on the streets. So things that you have helped establish that I believe are being replicated nationwide now. Are there other lessons you think that you have learned in your decades of work that really are now out there or need to be more out there among medical practitioners when they are dealing with people who are living on the streets?
When you go and try to take care of a homeless population or any, I suspect, any disenfranchised or excluded population, they will frequently teach us what's wrong in our mainstream healthcare system fast. So when I think of these things we pioneered, and I want to emphasize the we, because I've been surrounded by these amazing doctors and nurses and nurse practitioners and physician assistants who have really worked to make our program what it is. But we realized early on, like, for example, you know, we used to wait for people to come make appointments and come to see us an appointment, but homeless people live, you know, by moment to moment. Making an appointment 2 days from now at 4 in the afternoon just didn't make sense. So we had to learn how to have no appointments, just let people come in and see us and be available whenever they were. Lots of other things became clear. So the respite program, if I could take a second on that, was not our idea. It was the homeless folks themselves really angry with us doctors for discharging people from the hospital when they were really sick. And most people can go home and you have family and visiting nurses and home health aides. But when you go back to the streets or the shelters, you're still really fragile, really vulnerable, and still have to survive moment to moment. So they were upset and wanted a place where people could go and have 24-hour nursing and doctor care, just like anyone else. And they forced us, pretty much, with the help of Governor Dukakis back in those days, and we were given some space in one of the in the Lemuel Shattuck shelter to start to work on that. And rapidly, we learned that it became a place for people with AIDS, people that have been in the hospital for a while but were too sick and too fragile to be on the streets. And that has now evolved into what is our Barbara McGinnis House, named after the nurse who we all loved. And it's, you know, it's 100, essentially between our two programs, it's 124 beds, essentially step-down hospital where people, we can do end-of-life care. We do a lot of pre- and post-operative care for folks who are getting day surgery, people with chemotherapy, radiation, all sorts of things you can imagine. If you're homeless, how do you deal with that if you're out on the street? So the respite program is something we feel really proud of, but not our idea. I wish it had been, but it was their idea telling us we had to do it.
So you collectively have made a lot of advances to help people understand how people living on the streets should be treated. Are there lessons you think medical students of today need to understand? You talk, for example, in the book about certainty that doctors have, that they are trained to approach cases and to have a certain level of certainty. And you want to, you know, you're bringing out the idea that cases are complex, that the unknown will always be there, and that you need to listen and learn from the situation, that you can't approach everything with certainty. Is that one of the things that you think medical students of today need to know? Are there lessons that they can draw from what you've been doing?
We certainly learned firsthand that the way we had been trained in the hospitals and medical school, while really effective for most people, were not at all effective for people living on the streets or in the shelters who were too frightened or too paranoid or too reluctant to come in. And what we had to cope with is two things. One, time. It takes time. So I remember the nurses telling us, you've got to, you know, forget those professional boundaries. You've got to have coffee with people. You've got to talk to them. You've got to share stories, share some of yourself, and get to know them over time. And we were used to having 10 or 15 minutes to get to know that. And this was now stretching that out over small segments over months. And then the other thing was we had to really be careful about, you know, we're trained to know what to do, to tell people this is the best thing to do now. This is, you've got X and you need to take this medication. But with a lot of people who have been living on the streets in the shelters, it takes you a long time to really know what's going on, and you're never really sure. And what you do is stick with them over time, and then you become more sure. So I think from what our advice now to medical students and residents is certainly that you need to take time. It's hard to carve that out when you're in a pressurized system, but you also have to learn to live with a certain degree of uncertainty, unlike what we often see in medicine where we know what the diagnosis is, do the right treatment.
And one of the things you talk about is seeing the overwhelming percentage of trauma among your patients, dealing with the physical, the psychological effects of severe childhood trauma. You're often asked what can be done about homelessness. I know you're not a policy guy, or you don't want to be a policy guy. You prefer the medicine. But would you say that would be the most important focus with the effects of trauma? By the time you see many of your patients on the street, it's very difficult at that point to deal with all that has come before.
I used to think, I remember back in the 80s, I used to think I understood homelessness and knew what the solutions were. And I think as we've spent more time caring for this very eclectic group of people, that it's a very complicated issue and that solutions are not simple, and certainly no soundbite fits for that. And I think what we have come to acknowledge that we had to come to grips with the fact that I'm just a doctor and our team we're just doing healthcare. That isn't going to change the national tragedy of homelessness, but we can certainly take really good care of people. To fix the national tragedy, we have to have, without a doubt, housing. We have to have housing at a scale that we aren't even thinking of now. But for these very vulnerable folks, the ones living on the streets, chronically homeless, once they're in housing, they need an awful lot of support, because what you begin to realize is that what the social determinants of their ill health happened years ago in a school system that didn't work, in a foster care system that didn't treat them well, or in a blighted neighborhood where they were caught in a drug-infested community.
Many people assume you put a roof over someone's head, end of story, and it's obviously much more complicated than that. What can you say about how the homeless population has evolved? Are you able to say whether you're seeing more? I have heard from some who run shelters, there are a lot more women. The population is also definitely older now. What can you say from your observations?
That's a very difficult thing to say. We certainly, during waves, will see more women, more families, fewer families. So I think the lesson we've had is that there's a ebb and flow to homelessness, and different populations become more important or more prevalent. veterans, for example, I mean, about 17% of the men we used to see on the streets were veterans. Many were veterans of Vietnam. Most of them have now aged out of the system or died, and you now see these younger people who are veterans of the more recent wars. And the trauma there is just, you know, frighteningly awful. But then we, you know, I think what we see is this kind of bimodal thing where we certainly see those people who we've been caring for now for 20 and 30 years getting older, and we struggle with all the problems that I think every American family deals with as one of your, someone you care about gets older and cognitively impaired and all the things that come with aging. And then we also see a younger population who, you know, for all sorts of complicated reasons may now be suffering from a severe and persistent mental illness or drug use from something. And that's the other population we see growing.
I have to, this will have to be the last question. I have a million questions for you, but unfortunately this has to be it. In the book, there are a lot of references to you handing out cash. Now, as somebody who lived for many years in New York, groups there always said, don't give cash, give to the organizations. I know there are a lot of different opinions on that. What do you think people should do? Obviously pay attention more and certainly have more empathy, but what is it that you would advise them to do?
You know, and I apologize, this is all so controversial, but I learned from Barbara McGinnis and from Sister Margaret Leonard, who was ran a family shelter. They would give little bits of money whenever they had it to people. So I sort of grew up in a world where giving a little money was normal. I could talk to you about this. Even the Pope has said giving cash, you should give some. But I think what is most important is that when you see someone on the streets and they're asking for something, stemming as we would call it, the most important thing is to not look away, but just look them in the eye. The money is less important, I think, to most of them than the acknowledgement that they're a human being. So I think our giving money sort of stemmed out of getting to know people. But I would urge everybody, you don't have to give money or give a Dunkin' Donuts card. That turns out to be great. People can go in and get in the warm and have a cup of coffee and use a bathroom. That's fabulous. But
Just acknowledge
people. It's really, you know, honoring the humanity and the people you're seeing.
All right. I'm sorry I have to wrap. I could keep going with you. And I really, really am grateful for your time, Dr. Jim O'Connell. Thank you so much.
Oh, it's an honor to be here. Thank you so much.
The book again is called Rough Sleepers by Tracy Kidder, available now.